The AWARE Project's aim is to balance the public conversation about psychedelics, spread accurate information, and give a new face to psychedelia. We feel that this change will occur through connection and relationship, one individual at a time. We are calling on everyone whose lives have been improved through the mindful use of psychedelics to educate themselves and become ambassadors for the psychedelic experience. Show those around you that people who use psychedelics mindfully cross all social, racial, economic, and political boundaries.
Okay, so I'm really excited to introduce Lindsay. We actually met at our Bicycle Day event last year. So this is really exciting that you're here again. And I'm really excited about the documentary that you're gonna be talking about. Also, I'm in it, which I'm really stoked on. So it's been a really cool project to watch unfold, and I'm just thrilled to have you as a friend and thrilled for you to be here. So with that, here's Lindsay Kent. Stand right here, okay. Hi guys, happy bicycle day, everybody.
So this is the first part. Tess kind of want to get the feel for the crowd and kind of do like a little experiment. Don't worry, this is painless. Just everyone close your eyes for just 1 second. Just close your eyes. Everyone's eyes are closed. It's going to use your imagination. Now imagine that it's 1964. You've never heard of a psychedelic drug. You've never tried one. You've never been to a music festival. Maybe you're outside polishing your Ford Galaxy or walking out of a coffee shop to go to work, and you look up and you see a day-glow painted school bus with a bunch of crazy people hanging out of the sides, hooting and hollering, playing tambourines and recorders, and it pulls up and it stops right in front of you. Now, by a show of hands, who would get on that bus? All right. That's a great way to start. We're in the right place. I'm Lindsay Kent. I'm one of three directors of Going Furthur, which is a documentary on the 50th anniversary of the Furthur bus tour. So Zane Kesey, who's Ken Kesey's son, took the bus back out for 3 months. So the first trip was about, no one actually knows how long it is. People who were there, they have no idea. Like 10 days, 14 days. They honestly, they can't remember. So funny. But this was a 3 month tour of the East Coast. We went to Chicago, Madison, Wisconsin, like New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island. It was crazy. It was a lot of fun. And I just wanted to do a little bit of a background about me. But first, I wanted to introduce our narrator and producer, Alex Polinsky. Can you please come up here for a second? So we're going to be talking about this together because we kind of have two very different experiences of what it's like to be involved in this culture today. And kind of some of the values and ideas that got started 50 years ago and kind of where they are today and what's happening with them. So I kind of want to have him give you his background first.
Hi, everybody. Hi, I'm Alex. So background on me is I was a child actor. Show called Charles in Charge in the 80s. Anybody ever see it? I was Adam Powell, the little kid on that show. And I spent my life acting family. But notably, usually as kids you get a bedtime story, some bears or some moral to the story or some fantasy thing. But I got psychedelic stories. So my dad ran away from home at 15 and went to Haight-Ashbury during the 60s and got arrested with the Merry Pranksters and protested the war and did any psychedelic that came down the street and told me about it. And it was interesting, the first speaker who was talking about didn't really know how to talk to his kids. Well, the way I got talked to was just very clearly, it was about all the information that he could give me, what was good, what was bad. And as a result, I didn't do any experimentation until I was in my mid-20s. Supposedly when your brain is done forming, but it's never done forming. And by that time, I had all this background information, and I really made an informed decision, you know, that I wanted to try these things. But I didn't have that sort of, I'm going to try these things, and I run away and do it in a set and setting that was going to hurt me. I was one of the psychedelic children. Like, I was prepared for the experience. And I know that I'm not alone. I know there's quite a few of us. Just for a show of hands, how many people here whose parents... Over here, did your parents give you useful psychedelic information?
Hi!
Yeah, this is few and far between. Okay, so that's a good place to start.
Yeah.
What'd you say?
How about a parent that gave useful information?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. A parent, yes. So it's rare, but it happens. Towards the end of the story where I meet Lindsay, in the last 8 years, because of my work with psychedelics, because of my work with the acting community, because I'm an acting teacher, because my main job now is embodying superheroes and supervillains for animated projects, what that created in me was this ability to look at people as characters. And most notably in the electrochloride acid test,
ow, that was a trip. Not a good one. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Thank you. I should know these things. I should know these things. So I created this game called Avatarism, which is encouraging millennials and other people who are gamers to create themselves in the real world like they create their avatar for video games and for RPG and LARPing and cosplay and all these things. So bringing a whole culture of kids who kind of gets a psychedelic experience from playing these wild games, but maybe they've never tried anything, maybe they would never try anything, so I introduced things like meditation, mindfulness meditation, and character building, and fantastical character building, much like you would have if you were on a trip and everyone was being accepting at a festival or at a party and you're wandering around being your character. But we try to give kids this sort of experience without the psychedelic. So that's my trip that I'm on, and I've been going to psychedelic festivals and lecturing about how to create your character in the real world and how to get acceptance for it. Enter Lindsay, who came to one of the festivals I was speaking at, and I knew she was doing this documentary about Ken Kesey and the electric Kool-Aid acid test and the bus and everything. And I was like, I have to talk to you. I have so many things to say. I'm the next generation of prankster. Just look. You know? Check it out, sorry. Ow. Okay, you hold this now, I'm not qualified.
You didn't say the best part about how your dad knew Ken Kesey.
So, my dad was protesting the Vietnam War during a really pivotal time, and the cops came through. It was near Christmas, and they swept up everybody, and they brought them all to jail, and they spent Christmas in jail. And my dad was in there with Kesey and the Pranksters, and they got visited by Martin Luther King, they got visited by Bob Dylan, they got visited by all these luminaries because they were doing something that was really worthwhile, needed to be done. People brought gifts, it was an amazing experience, and so, you know, I feel like there is a real thing, our psychedelic ancestors, our psychedelic elders, that's a real thing. And we all sort of are existing, is it okay that I talk about this now, or do you want me to wait?
You can, like, dip in, it's like a toe.
Okay, so that I'm just,
later.
Yeah, that's it, that's all I'm gonna say. Till later.
So, very, like, veteran, obviously, of the scene. Now, I have been involved in this for less than 2 years, I would say, as someone who can say that I'm, like, involved in the scene and have taken and enjoyed LSD. I had the kind of stigma that a lot of people from my community do about, you know, brain man is just a rave in the desert. I know people do, you know, like that's like honestly what I was taught, and so that's what I believed. And I had tried MDMA and enjoyed it. I had tried psilocybin. My sister convinced me I was the Antichrist. Didn't do it for 4 years. When I tried it again, I enjoyed it, but I was on the fringes. Like I didn't really have like a really strong experience, anything to like any kind of shift any gears in like in a big way. And then I heard about this trip, not the movie, but that Ken Kesey's son, Zane, was going on this trip, and it was a Kickstarter campaign. So this is like January of 2014. And I read the electric Kool-Aid acid test in school. I love Jack Kerouac and Neil Cassidy, were like my boys. But, you know, I wasn't a big partier in school. I just always thought it would be, how cool would it have been to be on that bus? I was just like, when I read that book, I was like, man, cool. So like 10 years, I didn't even like think about it. But then I saw this campaign to get the bus back on the road. And at the very bottom, it said, we're gonna get everyone's cell phones, like videos, and put it together into this really cool like YouTube movie of like everything that happened. And I was like, whoa. So I'm a filmmaker, by the way, that's what I do. And I was like, hold on a second, this is a story that has to be told. And so I just kind of forced myself into it. I just brought my camera and showed up on the first leg of the tour, like, so I'm shooting this, so I'm doing this, this is happening. Which they accepted me, thank God. That would be really awkward if they didn't. But in that experience, and not on the bus, I should preface this by saying, there were no drugs on the bus, none, zero. Now, if people chose to partake at the events outside of the bus, if they're adults and they can do that, that's totally different. Don't ask any questions, but no drugs were on the bus. Saying Kesey will be super stoked that I said that. But I had my first LSD experience on this tour, and one of the most profound experiences of my entire life at the end of the tour with LSD. And I'm like, how come we aren't having these conversations? Like how have these people who I'm like speaking to, these are like luminaries, these are the people who were on the bus 50 years ago who are still around. Why isn't their story being told? And like, why don't we hear more about like this experience and what people are doing? Like, why is this so much in the background? So that's something that I kind of my own personal metamorphosis. But I do want to show a clip about psychedelics. This is like the big Millbrook scene. So the bus goes back. I'm sure some of you know about Millbrook and Tim Leary and what happened there on the bus. Went there 50 years ago, and you know they were on acid. And they showed up expecting a big party, and Tim and his pals were like not wanting that party. They weren't ready for it. They were coming down from a party, and so didn't happen. Didn't really jive. But the bus goes back there 50 years later, and so this is a scene from the film. Hope you guys enjoy.
Next stop, Millbrook, New York, to the former headquarters of psychedelic pioneers Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert, later known as Ram Dass. 50 years ago, these men were considered the leaders in mind-altering drug research. Ken and the Pranksters decided to drop in on these East Coast counterparts. Rumor has it, however, they received less than a warm welcome when they arrived.
Go away.
Should I be more hospitable than Larry was?
Hello.
Hi.
Ken Kesey.
And any of you on the original venture?
A little bit.
Well, yeah, I guess if you can remember it, you weren't there. Why don't you guys come in and take a look around?
They were just two radically different schools of thought. Leary and Alpert, you know, they were professors at Harvard University, and their entire approach was research-based. Where Kesey and the gang, it was really a cultural revolution, I think. Well, when the bus was going around America then, I mean, it was freaking people the fuck out. They were like, what is this? Who are these people? They're crazy. They escaped from a mental institution. So that was an equally powerful approach. It was not Timothy's approach at all.
LSD is not, as you say, a joy drug or a joy chemical.
Not at all.
But there seems to be quite a group of people who are taking it for a kick.
First of all, we have to ask the question, what is LSD? LSD is a chemical, but it's not a drug. It's a tool of education. It's a tool for every person who is responsible enough to use it to open up his consciousness.
Funny to think of people like Tim Leary and Dick Albert as being conservative, but from our perspective, they were using acid in a conservative manner. That's very valuable, But I think that by us doing it in the blatant, crazed manner that we did, we drew a lot of attention. Attention to alternative levels of consciousness. And that's the goal. That's the goal of all this shit. Alternative levels of consciousness.
This lecture on how to use your head could be summed up in one sentence. You have to go out of your mind to use your head.
We're all born, and when we come into age, and we're given all of these constructs to work with, working and going to school and achieving something. What psychedelics do is they kind of give you that little inkling that everything that you know is wrong. Everything that you think reality is, it isn't. And psychedelics are an amazing tool to sort of come around the backside of your lens and go, oh shit, things can be looked at in a different way.
Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
If people choose to have an experience with psychedelics, I think it creates a more connected and aware community. It's allowing us to see the impact that we have on ourselves and our environment and the whole world. And it just helps you sort of like see things in a bigger context. Everything has meaning, and it's so beautiful.
Now this aim is to change your view of man and maybe your view of yourself.
I'm not a believer that LSD is for everybody. It's really not. And of course, you know, the 60s was lightning in a bottle, and there was such an explosion, and the hippie revolution. There were some downsides, there were some dark sides, you know. But I think we've grown up from that now, and we're making good on our promise. And so psychedelics are fascinating and a powerful tool for us to tackle our great big problems that we're experiencing today.
I think that entheogens or psychedelics are a religious and civil right. They're the only proven, scientifically proven means to accessing the mystical experience.
Create the perfect environment, because you know you're not gonna do it that, I mean, I'm not gonna do it that often. So it's gotta be, everything's beautiful, and every worry and care in my life is set somewhere else aside. For now, make sure that you make something from that experience beautiful in the world, whatever it is, before you go ahead and do it again. Because this is, I think, the gift that Alex says this, the gift that we're supposed to help this beleaguered planet. So like, make beauty, make beauty. It really makes you want to make beauty. I think you've been having this bus and making all your stops, and you making such beauty. It's a piece, you know. It's a performance art. It's a work of community, collaborative.
Waging peace.
Waging peace.
Because you missed everything.
I was losing my mind, and I'm not. Thank God for that. Because now we get to dive into that topic. So as such a newbie, like diving into this culture and coming at it from such a backwards way, because I ended up I'm talking to Wavy Gravy and like in George Walker and these people who were the front runners. Like they are the ones who tested it out for us. You know, there was no framework, there was no maps. Yeah, you know, it was just taking these drugs and kind of like just figuring out what do we do. And a lot of people think that that the acid test graduation, which is coming up, the anniversary of that is on Halloween this year, that Ken Kesey was like pushed to do that because he was arrested. That is partially true. That is true, to hold it on that day and to do that. They wanted him to do that. But he also at the end, he sat everyone down and he had a conversation because he saw the same trip happening. Everyone was doing the same thing. And he could already feel, even though this is only like a few years old, he knew that there was a need to develop past that. And that's something that We can't even process because we stunted it at that level. We didn't get to that point where we got to like move past that. And so we had these people who were still alive, who were there, and who have this like this amazing story to tell. So it's kind of giving tribute to that lineage. Do you want to talk more about that?
I mean, the psychedelic lineage is real. It goes way back before history. These chemicals have been in our culture since time immemorial. It's our divine right to use them safely. And I just have such a different perspective because whereas a lot of people fight to see the efficacy or the usability or the, you know, it was always, I always knew what they were for. And so I feel like the lineage stepping forward, us enshrining these people who are gonna, obviously they're gonna be dying off soon in their 70s. And they never, how do I say this? Like, we encountered, you encountered a lot of the original psychedelic people, the original pranksters, which helped kick off this revolution. And a lot of them sadly are forgotten and are even jaded about the experience now because, well, we didn't care. So I just want to kind of empower you, entreat you, and maybe seduce you into looking back at our psychedelic elders and finding that that lineage really is real. These people are worthy of our worship, our thanks. People familiar with Sasha Shulgin, he was the scientist who brought out ecstasy for us, MDMA. And a little while ago, he just passed, and a good friend of mine, the T Fairy, who's one of the trip reporter for Arrowhead, she had this idea that put out this query, hey, how many people, just by a raise of hands, how many people have had a good experience on MDMA? You know, and if all the hands went up, she'd go, okay, well, what is that worth to you? Because the guy who created it is on death's door. And shouldn't we be taking care of our psychedelic ancestors? Isn't that important? Isn't that like taking care of any other luminary that changed our brains and helped us live better? And I think the answer is yes. So I gave money and a bunch of people supported him so we could have round the clock nurses up until his death. So we stepped up and we did it as a community. We supported these people. These people are important. Who's gonna hold it down for mirth? Who's gonna hold it down for joy and exploration? These people are a tribe that definitely deserve our attention and our love.
Yeah, and that's part of what, you know, this documentary didn't really start out that way, but it has evolved into that because, you know, we're like bridging a pretty big gap. I wish I could include all of the stories because it's the like hour long conversations with these people is just absolutely mind blowing, but just the recognition of you know kind of where we started and where we came from and how we can move that forward, like just the conversation about like set and setting and how important that is, like how massively important that is because you can try it once in the wrong set or setting or both, you'll never do it again, you know, and so that's something that I think is really important. I kind of want to segue now into talking about one of the other values that you kind of touched on, but that I think is really important is what happens to you after you get to a certain point in your trip or your experience with LSD or psilocybin. I think the study just came out this week. They mapped people's brains taking LSD and they could pinpoint these different places that were connecting that didn't normally connect. And it was bypassing other places that normally connected. So basically, they could physically see how it is literally our ego steps aside, and we're like, "Oh shit, we're actually really all connected." And this is the individual is this illusion. And so they can actually physically see it now. Wow, that just happened. So as people are developing this and taking this in a responsible manner, like what one of the things that starts to happen is they get a new form of identity, like not the one that society gave them and who they were told that they should be, but now it's like, okay, who do I really want to be? Who do I really feel like, and how can I express that? And now there's music festivals and beautiful places where that is encouraged and and there's no judgment. You can be whatever you want to be. And in that environment, when you're around people who are completely uplifting you as this person that you are, literally feel the depths of your soul you are, how does that open you up to other parts of your life that you have like had closed off? Like what if you were hiding parts of yourself that needed to come out, and now you have this beautiful place where you're free to do that, what else do you get to discover and learn and become? And that's something that I personally experienced by being involved in this culture and doing this festival circuit. And do you want to talk and then I'll show the clip, or do you want me to show the clip and then you talk? Okay, I'm gonna show one more clip. This is the Great North Festival.
Rock and roll and tattoo history. I love my art. I love being able to be trusted by people, to put my art permanently on their skin.
Oh my God! Best tattoo ever!
As these pranksters unite as a team, individual personas are maturing. At the Great North Festival, the last festival on the tour, they have a chance to embody their truest character.
Somebody is everybody's somebody, because I really believe that everybody is somebody. And if we treated everybody like somebody special, the world would be such a better place. We all have our passion. We all have our inner child that wanted to play a certain way until we got bogged down in a system that told us this is the only way to be. And we have to deviate from the norm in order to evolve. Characters are important because we're creating our story. You get to write your own character every day in every way. So make it as flamboyant and freaky and fun as humanly possible.
Your life is a movie, and you're watching your own life as a movie. Out of all characters in life, what would be the most entertaining for yourself?
For me, character is everything. Your vision of yourself that makes you excited and a little nervous to manifest. It's that. Festival culture is very forgiving of characters. And you can wander through a festival and embody basically whatever you like and be accepted for it, as long as it doesn't hurt anybody and it's, you know, good for everyone, good for yourself.
You think that you're weird or crazy, and you're probably right, but that's not a judgment. That's an amazing thing to be different. I encourage anyone who ever feels left out or that they don't belong to follow their heart and stay true to themselves, because you're going to attract people like that into your life.
We are a tribe that is planetary. And you can go to any country practically and find your tribe. It behooves us to find in our hearts our unity and our sense of purpose in creating a better world. Because it's going to take a lot of imagination, a lot of love, and a lot of heart to turn things around. But I think that that is the mighty mission of creativity.
So this is actually Alex's baby. So this is actually, so how I met Alex is I took his avatarism workshop. Who has heard of the Lucidity Festival in Santa Barbara? Who's been?
Woo!
Yeah. So great. I didn't get to go this year. I was at Esalen instead, so. It's a tough life. Someone's gotta do it. Might as well be me though. But so I actually took his course, if anyone has a chance to take this, please do. It actually went overtime. It was like almost 2 hours because we just didn't want to leave. We just sat there just like creating our own character, like taking all the things that all the parts of ourselves that we don't like, and then all the things that we really truly want to be, and discovering that and creating that. And it was a mind-blowing experience. And this is my very first day, and I've never even had, this is my first day at a transformational festival ever. And then I talked to him for an hour and a half afterward, and I'm like, okay, you're gonna be a producer on the film, and you're narrating, and you're telling everyone about this, so I'll let him take it from there.
Whoa. I feel like psychedelics cause conversations. I feel like psychedelics cause conversations not only with different people, but you can literally have a conversation with a part of your body. Your heart can talk to your mind, your digestive tract can talk to your ear. You could have a lot of interesting body awareness that wasn't there before. And actually, that really, really helped me. I wouldn't have had this mind-blowing idea about how we all have been creating our characters since the beginning of time without my experiences. I found that by looking at people in the psychedelic culture, I could intuit that this thing about creating ourselves away from whatever degenerate programming we might have been given or whatever mistaken choices we made about our character before we knew what choice was. We were little kids. I'm gonna be this way forever, fuck you. And then you just go with it, and then you have a psychedelic experience and you look back at all those decisions and everything suddenly makes sense. Avatarism is an inquiry into the nature of character itself. And I think that one of the things that we all do when we experience different states of mind, we change our brains, we really are never the same. And hopefully it's for the good. Sometimes people get freaked out, that's the nature of the thing, but I think the more education we have about what it is, and my dad used to say to me, I'd call him up after every psychedelic trip, and I'd say, Dad, I tripped really hard, and he'd say, oh good, what'd you learn? And I'd tell him, and so that became the history of how I experience entheogens is as a learning experience and as a tool. So what I would just like to say about our character and the character of psychedelic people in general is, and I think I'm kind of paraphrasing, oh my God, I'm blanking on his name. Who's the psychedelic guy who talks
Alex
like
Ray?
This? No, the other one.
Terrence
McKenna. And that's another funny story because after you do acid, like, you get that laugh. You know, it's like this joyful, confident thing. And you feel like, whoa, it's a crazy laugh. I'm like, well, you haven't been where I've been. But Terrence McKenna said, you know, you can't make your movies. You can't make your magazines. You can't make your toys. You can't make your cartoons. You can't make anything without psychedelic people. We are ingrained into culture. We're fairly secretive because a lot of the muggles, mundanes, normal people don't understand. And they have to be brought in a specific way. They gotta be brought in a specific way. So it's up to us to be the character that takes a stand for the positivity and the saneness of how we use these chemicals. And by our light, and the light that we collect from our experiences, we illuminate their path. And their path is made brighter and more clear by what we have gone through. And it's, you know, the whole thing with coming out of the closet. And the Aware Project is beautiful. I've had your sticker on my fridge for a while, and every time I go, I'm like, I'm coming out of the closet. Coming out of the closet. I'm like this. I live on the edge of West Hollywood, so, but I'm not gay, so I'm like, I've always wanted to come out of the closet, join my brothers, sisters, but now I can. And I know, talk about tangents. But really, and I'll end with this, and I'll give the mic back to you, because I have noticed that I was an acting teacher for many years. I come from a long line of acting teachers and Tony winners and, you know, Broadway people, and like, I have this thing in my blood. It's like a family business. I say if my family were plumbers, I would have plumbed, but I acted. And I realized that in acting classes, every single one I went to, eventually you got down to, why can't I do this? Why can't I do this thing I really want to do? And you go, well, it's attitude change. There's a brain change that needs to happen. You can't separate talent and success and all the from attitude. And I may or may not have candy flipped at an Indian reservation in 90. May, I don't know. But when I may have done that, I awoke from a history of being a child actor who was famous in teen magazines and really thinking that I was like, there was something about me that was really fucking special. And you know, there is, but it's like, it was the special flower syndrome, right? And I'd had this experience and I remembered that who I was, and just like the creation of beauty, it sounds like a platitude, but as a character, it's our highest expression, our highest. And you don't have to be an artist, but just making something beautiful. And it doesn't even have to be something tangible. It could be an experience, like being a stand for another person that needs illumination about their path. Thanks.
I love that so much. Please take that this course. Honestly, it's amazing. So I just want to show one more clip and just how we kind of ended the festival circuit, and what I kind of like dove into towards the end of the film is how we're taking this culture further, and like, so what's happening at these festivals and what kind of conversations are happening. So it's like once you either have a psychedelic trip or just a trip to a festival or some way where you're you know, broken open in some way, and then you start to embody the character that you want to be, and you have more of a capacity and time to focus on other things, what do you want to focus on? Helping people, helping other people, helping where we live. That's a natural thing. It's a human being thing. It's not like you or you. It's all of us. Once we get out of our own shit, all we want to do is help other people do the same thing. It's a natural thing. So it's like, I wanted to dive into the bigger conversations and the things that are really happening at these festivals that matter. And so I'm going to show you a really quick clip, and then we'll be done.
Coming. I believe in the good things coming. It's difficult to describe to people, and I think it's because it's so absent from our culture, what it feels like to spend 3 days with humans. I mean, really, like your humanity is reawakened, you really get to see the good in people, you collaborate. Coming. Deep breaths for young men, learning.
Can't we just stay here? Can't we just build it and stay and really live like this all the time, sustainably and simply and synergistically with each other?
Every fire kindle burning, I believe in the good things coming.
It helps us look forward to the next 7 generations and the way that we want to leave a planet. It's impossible to go to more than one of these and not bring a little bit of that home with you every single time.
And the intention behind these festivals, there's a lot of hope, I feel like, that comes from them. Festivals now are reaching towards a higher purpose that I'm actually very, like, proud to say that I'm a part of now, because we are looking for something that has deeper meaning.
All of you are participating right now in the Great Awakening of Consciousness, and let's take some of that power, let's take some of that mana, Let's take that good energy and let's focus it in, because right now there's a war for water happening in this country. And things like fracking and coal seam gas and all of these outdated methods that use wastewater, use oil, waste oil, all to create natural gas, it's not healthy. It's bad for our water, it's bad for our communities. So this next song on the verge is to take a stand against fracking and to use our energy as we gather here to direct it towards something positive, which is keeping our rivers, our lakes, and our waters free. Thank you so much.
We have something deeper that we need to connect into again. And if in the next 50 years, we tap into that, and those of us who are experiencing this take the movement further and say, okay, where are our gardens? Are our waters protected? Are we speaking on behalf of what's really happening? We'll thrive regardless.
We need to take that consciousness and even take it a step further and really get it back into the mainstream. I mean, we see tremendous strife in the world today and in this country today, and we see ourselves kind of as a global collective kind of progressing in some areas. That's where the work lies. And I think, you know, getting away from our computers and actually coming together in human form to talk about these issues is where we need to go next. You know?
There's been a lot of education at these festivals, and I think that that's the sort of the best part of them, is that innately they're there for your benefit and for you to have a better experience and take that same experience, bring it back to the general world culture and influence people positively in your day-to-day life.
Awesome. So, at this stage, do you have anything else to say, or should we open up for Q&A?
If you're interested in the game that I'm creating called Avatarism, avatarism.net, and there's a free character sheet, I recommend doing it both in a elevated state and non-elevated state.
Awesome. Does anyone have any questions about anything we talked about, or the bus, or anything, or want to share a story? Yes. Magic Trip. Yeah. Yeah. It was the first time. So and we go into a little bit more detail at the top of this film. We kind of explained this whole thing because they thought they were filming a movie. Like, they went on this trip. They just painted up like a bunch of their friends. They weren't trying to start anything cool. They brought a bunch of acid. Not even a bunch of acid. Not that much. They dosed like 3 times the whole trip. Everyone's like, oh, they're on acid the whole time. We all know here you can't do that. Okay. First of all. They wanted to film a movie. Ken Kesey knew that movies was like it's the next thing, you know. Screw books, I'm gonna be a movie maker. But they didn't know what they were doing. So they had like different frame rates, you know, they had like 24 frames a second film, and then the audio was running a different frame rate, and they got it at home and they're like, sweet shit, like, how do we put this together?
Didn't match up.
They couldn't figure out how to do it. And so they just started playing the footage just like strung together without any sit, well, obviously without any sound, because they couldn't figure out how to do that. On the wall at Kesey's place with like a bunch of light shows, and they all took acid, and that's the acid tests. And this band called the Warlocks, who became the Grateful Dead, played these shows. And that's how the acid test got started. That's how this whole culture like got birthed in these tests that started in this house in La Honda, California. Ooh, okay. I had a point. Anyway. Nope, it's gone. Chew. I'm sure someone else will ask and remind me. But the film is going to be premiering at the Maui Film Festival in June, which is really exciting. We're also doing an East Coast tour of the film. If anyone is going to be in New York or Connecticut or Rhode Island in the summer, we're going to Chapel of Sacred Mirrors, Alex Gray's place, on July 8th. It's going to be really fun. We're showing it at Cosmo.
So you can come to Alex Gray's temple and his temple and see the movie for the first time there in that setting, which I think would be amazing.
Would be really cool. Could
come to Cosmo and see that. So.
Should be really amazing. We're also doing a very private, free screening of the film next month for friends and luminaries and all of you people here because you showed up, basically. I'm not really sure what the venue is going to be yet, but if you are interested, I'll have like a list. You can put your email down, and as soon as we have more info, send you that stuff. More questions? Did you get all the questions already? Sweet. Now you guys know everything. Thank you guys.